Hi, my name is Leon Rowe, currency trader and trading coach at trading180.com, and welcome to this week's Supply and Demand, Forex and Gold Fundamental and Technical Analysis for the week ahead, starting the 17th of June. And before we get started, just a quick reminder to please like, subscribe and share this video content with your trading colleagues, trading mates, and it's a good way to support the channel, a free way to support the channel if you find the content that I provide useful. I'd really appreciate it. So starting off a different kind of format this week than I typically do. And I'm starting off really with some trade analysis and kind of like trade of the week kind of thing. And then also as well, a trade update before we get into the what the news is, the macros, and then we get into the upcoming technicals. So starting off really in trade of the week for me, and this is a trade that I took, was on the silver to euro pair, and not really a pair that I obviously talk about on the Sunday videos, but the reason I took it was really kind of based on the European elections. So I was already had a kind of a bit of a short bias on the euro because they have started their cutting cycle now. On Sunday there was a bit of a shock when it came to when it came to Europe, and on the Monday morning, early hours of Monday morning, I sent this to the private Discord members group area, and I just said, "Morning, everyone. The euro is likely a sell over the next few weeks due to Sunday's surprise poll results," and then I basically linked to our Eurozone news channel. "And the market likes stability, so it will be difficult for the euro to gain any appreciation in the short term." And then pretty much posted another article that basically was kind of breaking down the political uncertainty around the euro. And it kind of caught me by surprise as well in terms of the results. It just says here, it says, it is events in France that have hit the headlines. President Macron's party has performed so poorly, gathering just 15% of the vote, that he's dissolved parliament and called elections for 30th of June. So second round is the 7th of July. This move is widely seen as a gamble, either to question the French electorate on whether they really want a far-right government, or to give the electorate 3 weeks, 3 years experience with far-right government ahead of the next French presidential election in 2027, while Marine Le Pen's National Rally Party has shifted away from the anti-euro manifesto it ran in 2017, fears about shifting support for Ukraine stand to unnerve markets. So essentially, the status quo is over, right, in terms of potentially being disrupted. The markets like certainty, and there's a lot of uncertainty in Europe, which then had an effect on the euro. Now, it didn't quite play out in terms of the euro selling off against the silver. So it sold off against other currencies and currency pairs, but against silver, it didn't start to devalue until around Thursday, Friday. So Thursday, this was an interesting setup. And for those of you who know how to trade stop hunts, this was a stop hunt setup that I trade. And on the Thursday evening, I actually saw a move to the downside. And again, you know, with everything that was going on with Europe, I thought, you know, in the morning it was best to look for a trade setup once we came back inside this level. So that was one of my entries. And then what I typically do is enter a limit, buy a limit order at 50% of the move, 50% retracement, and then about a 95% retracement, I enter into a trade here. In fact, that should be really there, and that should be here, about 1-to-1, right? So then my stop losses are all in the same place. They were around that 26.47 area. So I have, good risk reward as I'm going to the upside. So basically, as prices came down, triggered me into my 95% buy limit as well, it bounced right back, quick 1-to-1 on that trade. So that was a nice profit. And then we went to the upside. And when prices came up to around that 27.37 area, that's where the second profit was taken. And now I'm looking to hold this silver euro trade to the upside, around, you know, somewhere around 80% of the highs, so of the market highs around here. So two positions made in profit, and then looking for this to move to the upside. So that was the silver euro trade, and an update as well on some trades that I am now out of, and the dollar Swiss. So last week I went over the entry on the dollar Swiss and why I was long from last week, and I again was entering into four positions rather than three positions. I was quite bullish on the dollar at the time because we had non-farm payrolls come out way above what the forecast was. Unemployment rate did tick a bit higher, but I thought that the dollar was more of a buy than a sell. And also as well, I entered again into some trades, some pending buy, pending orders, and then, you know, split this up into another three positions. So on the Wednesday, what had happened was is that inflation came out lower than expected. And so I was prepared to cancel these orders if inflation went out, came out against me. So as prices shot down on the news, what I ended up doing was cancelling my market order, which was here, right? So I cancelled this market order for a small loss. And then also ended up, because of the speed of the move to the downside, I did get triggered into this this position here. And so I ended up cancelling that position somewhere around the 18 areas. So again, another small loss on here. Now, at the time, we were basically breaking down the this trade, right? And a lot of traders were looking at this as in terms of when prices pulled back, as to why are prices pulling back. Now, in real time, when we were observing all this happening on the day, so this was Wednesday the 12th of June, in the Discord room, I was posting, you know, some things, having a conversation with the traders, and I saw this on Trading Economics, and they, you know, one thing that stuck out to me was that it said U.S. consumer inflation data released today is unlikely to influence the Federal Reserve. So, 1:30 in UK time, you had CPI come out, but then you had FOMC later on that evening. And so I think the market was really kind of, although again, CPI came out, I think the market was hoping that the, based on inflation, you know, going lower than expected, that the, you know, Jerome Powell would be dovish, right? Because it made sense, and that rate cuts are coming sooner. But at the time, before his FOMC release, you know, we were talking about the fact that it was dovish. And what I said was, you know, is the question is whether this will alter the Fed's thinking about cuts in September, right? So that was the key. Regardless of what the data says, the continuation of a sell of the dollar was really based on whether the Fed were going to come out later on and also be dovish, right? And so again, I just kind of repeated that in response to Addy, and said, let's see later if the Fed agree that inflation is coming down enough to start to warrant cuts sooner, right? That is the key. And then you know, we had just again another response to Mark, and I said, if, you know, Powell confirms later politically, it may give, you know, cover justification for cuts before the election, because in response to him saying everything looks on track for September cuts. So again, it wasn't a certainty, of course. We did not know, and it's sometimes it's best to be cautious about the data, because ultimately, again, it's really about, yes, the data coming out, but what will that data really affect the Fed's thinking? And so the market had at the time, increased its rate, the probability of a rate cut to about 70%. I think it was up here, so an ease, whereas the day before it was about maybe 48%, 46% chance of an ease. And then on the Wednesday, basically it increased to about 70% based on the data. But as we know, or how we now know, is that the Fed were actually quite hawkish. And again, just the last little comment I put on here, and I said an ease is now 77% priced in. Again, Powell releases his dot plots later, so be mindful if getting short between now and his speech. So again, I was urging caution, and I know a lot of traders who would have been going short here based on this very bearish candle definitely would have been stopped out and cleared out, because basically Powell came out later on and was a lot more hawkish, and I'll get into that a bit later. So that ended up being a small loss on the dollar Swiss. And finally, I am out of the Australian dollar Swiss franc. And again, this was a trade that was very similar to the the silver euro trade, another stop hunt. And just to kind of break this down again, first market order at this area here, 50% pullback pending order, and then a 95% pending order. Managed to get, again, profit on this one. So you can see when prices started to pull back, never touched my stop loss. Came back, banked that profit. So that was that. And then when prices started to move a lot higher, banked that profit. Excellent one-to-one. And then I had this position now open, right, to try to hold this trade to the upside. But prices reversed. Before prices reversed, I did move my stop up to just below this this swing here, because I thought it was quite a strong move to the upside. I didn't think prices would come back down that far, and also protecting some of the profits that I had. So ultimately, I did lose this trade when prices stopped me out here. That's fine, because, you know, basically two wins and one very small loss, pretty much half of that position. So I'm now fully out of that, the Aussie Swiss, although I am looking to get back into it this week, because there are some central bank announcements, and I think there's going to be some volatility to get involved in, both for the Australian dollar and the Swiss franc. So, with all that being said, let's get into the week ahead. So in the United States, key economic indicators such as retail sales, manufacturing and services, PMI, industrial production will be closely watched. Additionally, speeches by several Federal Reserve officials will garner significant attention. Globally, central bank decisions in Australia, Switzerland and the United Kingdom will be of paramount interest. Manufacturing and services PMI data will be published for Australia, Japan, Germany and the Euro area, and the United Kingdom. In the UK, critical data releases include the inflation rate and retail sales figures. Germany's ZEW Economic Sentiment Index will also be a key focus. China will release a slew of important economic data, including industrial production, retail sales, house prices, and unemployment rate. Finally, in Japan, the trade balance and inflation rate will be closely monitored. So, lots going on this week. So, let's now get into the week ahead and looking at some of the technicals. Now, starting off on the equally weighted dollar index, if you want to know about this, I have a video. If you click on the top right hand side of the screen, I've got a link that shows you how to add this to your chart, as well as the other currency indexes, and really why I use the equally weighted dollar index rather than the DXY or the USDX. So looking at the dollar overall, again, we're in this bit of a range, bit of an auction. between this high and this low right here. And we've come up basically due to Jerome Powell being quite hawkish. So in between really this supply zone and this demand zone. So looking at the Federal Reserve in the United States, it says here the Federal Reserve's move to signal fewer interest rate cuts this year deepens its divergence from peers who have already begun to ease. So the message from the Fed was twofold. Not only are officials now only anticipating one rate cut this year, so that was what happened on the Wednesday at the FOMC meeting. He reduced the amount or what they're anticipating in terms of cuts from 2-1 from 3. And it says that they compared to, sorry, let me read that whole message again. I kind of messed that up. So it says the message from the Fed was twofold. Not only are officials now only anticipating one rate cut this year compared to the 3 they projected as recently as March, but they also see its easing cycle bottoming out at a higher level than previously expected, underscoring the era of higher rates is set to stay. So pretty hawkish overall. When we look at what actually happened on the Wednesday, although we did have some dovish data. So I do expect the dollar to appreciate. And so the dollar for me is really more of a buy on pullbacks. So any pullbacks down to this area here, if we can get something or even lower, I think are more buy opportunities. Or if prices do make higher highs and then pull back to an area of newly created demand, then that would be more of a buy. But of course, the data has to support the narrative. The minute that data doesn't support Fed hold for longer or one rate cut, then I think the dollar should be more of a sell. But at the moment, it is a close call. Depends on, you know, what side you're on, either the market side or the Fed side. The market at the moment doesn't look like it's believing the Fed too much. But if the Fed are right about inflation data and economic data, then the market has to then readjust. And if the market readjusts, that's the opportunity for the dollar to move a lot higher. Looking at the dollar yen and the dollar yen, we did get a bit of a pullback down into this demand zone, and they're going to move higher. So some higher highs, higher lows being made. Now the yen did have some news this week, and it said here that the Bank of Japan is making investors wait until its July meeting for details on its pairing of bond buying, sparking renewed weakness in the yen and pushing back of bets on an interest rate hike next month. So traders were surprised by the Bank of Japan's decision on Friday to flag a cut in debt purchases without laying any figures or timeline. That's being seen as a delay in the normalization of policy. Normalization of policy meaning rate hikes. Given that more than half of economists surveyed by Bloomberg had expected the central bank to begin cutting its purchases. So the Bank of Japan making some dovish moves, which is causing obviously prices to go, the yen to weaken, but also at the same time, obviously getting some bullishness on the dollar. So I do think any pullbacks back into a level, into a demand zone. And the chart is getting a little bit messy, but ultimately this is how we have to kind of draw it. I do think any pullbacks into the lower end of this demand zone is going to be decent for a nice buy. But if you do want to be a buyer of the yen against the US dollar, I do think probably maybe around the 160s, maybe the highs, might be a nice area to look for a short, if not now. But again, you really have to be very bullish on the yen and very bearish on the dollar. Dollar Swiss, now I actually like this for a buy this week. So even though I cancelled my trades, This week we do have a Swiss bank central bank announcement. So if they do end up cutting rates, I mean, it's projected, they're projected to hold rates, which is the reason why the Swiss franc has been appreciating this week. So it went from really a cut to recently a kind of change in sentiment with the Swiss National Bank recently, and the market took it as kind of hawkish. So you've seen the Swiss franc start to appreciate. But the Swiss National Bank have been known to surprise the market and wrong foot the market. So I do think anything from around now down into the 0.886s, down to the 0.884s, if prices do something like that before the announcement on Thursday, then I'm looking at long trades on this currency pair. If you are looking for short trades, then you are probably looking at this high right here, just below the 0.90 area. But my bias is to really kind of buy the dollar and sell the Swiss franc. Now, again, if the Swiss franc and the Swiss National Bank come out and they hold rates, I still want to be a seller of the Swiss franc, but I may have to kind of hold fire and wait for maybe a little bit of lower levels before I look for long trades. Dollar, Canadian dollar, and again this week, a bit topsy-turvy, of course, had a massive move to the upside, and then we came back down into the demand zone and then bounced off of there. Now, I think Canadian dollar is a sell, so I think for me, any trades around now or just a bit higher, I think should be actually nice short trades. So anything from now to and if prices do go a bit higher, short trades, meaning not short trades, right, long trades. I'm short in the Canadian dollar and long in the pound, sorry. Any pullbacks into this demand zone again will be nice buying opportunity to buy the US dollar and short the Canadian dollar. So that's really where my bias is at the moment. No reason to really buy the Canadian dollar. Again, they're on their cutting cycle. They cut recently. So I think the Canadian dollar might be a bit of a buy if data again supports more of a hold rather than further cuts in July. Pound, dollar, and the pound selling off a bit, obviously, against the dollar. Dollar gaining some strength. Politically, the British pound is being influenced by the election. And so it does look like Labour are going to have the majority and a massive majority. And if that is true and if it does come to pass, then pretty much a lot of analysts are projecting that the pound should be pretty stable. But then after that really comes the Bank of England interest rate cuts. Now, going to the UK channel, there was some news this week, and it was the economy, I think month for month, came out and flatlined. And it was saying here that the economy is cooling after it returned to growth with a bang at the start of the year. In the context of the election campaign, the number won't do much to boost Prime Minister Rishi Sunak's chances of re-election. For the Bank of England, the print shouldn't carry much bearing. Our base case is softer headline, and services inflation will clear the way for a rate cut in August. It says here as well, despite the disappointing figures, a June interest rate cut looks improbable, with the Bank of England likely to be a little wary of shifting policy in the middle of a general election campaign, says Suren Thiru, Economic Director at the Institute of Chartered Accountants in England and Wales. And so rate cuts unlikely to come, this month, next month, probably in August. So that should support the pound, continue to support the pound. Maybe not against the dollar, but against other currencies, especially like, for example, the euro and the Canadian dollar, right? So the longer central banks hold is the more supportive it is. So, but on this pair, not really interested in trading this pair But if you are, then I think now is a nice time to look for a buy trade. If you're looking for sell short trades and buying the US dollar against the British pound, then that's really where you want to look for any kind of pullbacks around the 128 to 129 areas. But again, this pair, not really a pair I'm looking to trade at all. British pound yen. So the British pound yen did have a bit of a spike up, a bit of a pullback, kind of stop hunts in this area, but that would mean that you really think that you want to be a buyer of the yen, which I'm not. More buyer of the pound. So really kind of pullbacks into this demand zone, and deeper into this demand zone is where I would look for some trades. So pullback into here, the 197 area, and even better if you can get 196, 195s, I think, would be a nice buy trade on the pound yen. Not looking to buy the yen at all. Euro dollar. So I know a lot of traders would have got caught out on the euro dollar this week. Of course, traders could have made some money, you know, but ultimately, I think after FOMC, traders definitely would have been caught on the wrong side of the market. So Monday came out, of course, on Monday morning. We did have, you know, more selling due to the politics within the euro. And also as well, one of the other things to kind of add to this is that the Eurozone, if you're not aware, the European Union are going into a bit of a trade war with China, which will and could affect their economy if it does escalate. So it says here, the European Union will slap tariffs, additional tariffs of as much as 38.1% on electric vehicles shipped from China as of next month, escalating a global trade war and upping the cost of selling cars in Europe for companies ranging from China's BYD Co. To Tesla Inc. And if that doesn't really make much sense to you and you're wondering what the big deal is a trade war is, I say trade war, but basically trade tensions. And the situation is that in Europe, and with this move towards, globally anyway, towards the push towards electric vehicles, cheaper Chinese electric vehicle imports are hurting the European market, right? EV market. Because as a consumer, you know, if you're, you know, in Europe and you're switching over to electric vehicles, you're going to want to buy a cheaper, or you're likely to buy a cheaper, you know, electric vehicle than you are a more expensive one, right? And so China having and selling cheaper electric vehicles within Europe, although isn't necessarily a problem, it's becoming one, or has now become one, because it's hurting, and the European Union have actually recognized now that it's hurting and it's going to hurt the manufacturing in Europe. Like, for example, Mercedes selling their electric vehicles, and, you know, I don't know, BMW or whoever, right? And so you know, it's really about the European Union kind of protecting their industry, right? And so what they need to do by slapping a tariff on of 38.1% is make Chinese imports a lot more expensive, so then it becomes more of an even playing ground, right? And an even consumer shopping ground, because then European consumers won't necessarily always go for the cheaper option. They might then, if you know, all cars are competitively priced, both homegrown and the exported electric vehicle market, then the European electric vehicle market has more or can have a bit more what's the word I'm looking for? They can look to be a bit more competitive, you know, with China. And so we see here that China has signaled it's ready to retaliate, threatening measures across agriculture, aviation, and cars with large engines. So China are basically saying that, well, okay, if you're going to increase the tariffs on our goods and the goods that we sell to you, then the main goods that you sell to us, we're going to put tariffs up on those. So obviously, Europe, export agriculture, aviation, and cars with large engines, right, to China. And so there's a tick for tack going on, which again is going to hurt trade between both countries. And so both countries' economies may start to suffer if, you know, there can't be an agreement made. And, this chart kind of summarizes it when we look at, you know, Chinese electric car sales in Europe grow from low base. So in 2020, 4 years ago, it was only 1.1%. right, of European EV market share of Chinese brands, right? And then we've basically, you know, increased to now 6.9%, Chinese brands being sold in European markets. And that trend is obviously worrying for the European Union. And so basically they're trying to make Chinese imports cars more expensive. So as long as that continues, you've got not only the ECB cutting rates, the European Central Bank cutting rates, trying to devalue their currency, you've got politics and political uncertainty, which the market doesn't like, which is weighing on the euro, and also a potential trade war with China, who are basically the world's economic engine, weighing also on Europe. And so buying the euros, regardless of this massive, you know, bullish candle, was never really the smartest idea, because ultimately, this was what was likely to happen sooner or later, right? So at the moment, for me, the euro is more of a sell than a buy, much more of a sell than a buy. And again, when you have the fundamentals not on your side, there's no demand zone that's going to stand in the way of fundamentals and technical analysis. So we do have a pullback in terms of, you know, this move to the upside, but ultimately for me, the path of least resistance is to the downside. Now I do want to look for short trades, and when you've got a wide zone between 107s to 108s in terms of a demand zone, the area that I would then look towards breaking it down would be where there's likely some sort of support and resistance in that area. And you can see that where there's daily resistance there, support, bit of resistance, although it's spiked up somewhere around there. And then I'd look for any kind of pullbacks into that zone would be a decent area to look for any kind of short trades on the euro dollar. Of course, if you do want to go long on the euro, now would be a decent time, but you would really want all the risk sentiment to kind of evaporate on Monday before looking to go long. Euro yen, again, euro yen, the euro should be selling off against the yen in terms of risk sentiment. So I think any pullbacks into an area, maybe somewhere around here, would be decent. If you want to look for a buy on the euro against the yen, I think now is probably a decent time to look for any kind of long trades. But again, for me, I'm not really looking to buy the yen at the moment. Euro pound, again, the pound being in a much better position fundamentally than the euro, and economic stability, you have, you know, prices basically have sold off, right? So any pullbacks into supply zones are decent areas to look for some short trades. I mean, you could look for a short trade around here. Personally, I'd prefer any pullbacks up into the 85 area to look for a short trade. Australian dollar, I think, is a buy, or hopefully it is. There is the RBA have got an interest rate decision. They're expected to hold rates But it's really about the forward guidance that they give and whether they're hawkish or dovish. I think they're likely to remain hawkish. And so I do think that the Australian dollar is a buy. I wouldn't buy it against the US dollar personally. But if you are looking for a buy against the US dollar, I think a pullback into that zone is quite nice. There is an area of, again, support and resistance within this area that has served quite well. So anywhere around here would be decent for a potential buy. If you're looking for short trades, then yeah, you're looking for really kind of, I'd say, a pullback up top, really above the level, fresh area of supply would be decent for a short trade. And that means that you're buying the US dollar against the Australian dollar. But I'm not looking to trade this pair at all. Not until the Federal Reserve really kind of establish that they are in their rate cutting cycle. Gold should appreciate across the board, not necessarily against the dollar at the moment, because again, the dollar is on hold. When I say appreciate across the board, I'm more talking about if you're trading gold against other currencies, like for example the euro. But I think for now, gold may be kind of caught between maybe this high and this low and this supply and demand zone. So I think gold is definitely way more of a buy if we can get the Federal Reserve to start cutting soon. I say we can, but if inflation and the data shows that. But I don't expect gold to really make new highs anytime soon, unless of course there are escalations in any kind of risk events, major electoral upsets, escalations in war, for example. I do think that overall gold should be a buy. Gold and silver are obviously a buy, but against the dollar, it might be a little bit tough going forward in terms of appreciation for gold. But I think any pullbacks should probably be more buying opportunities anyway. So if we do get a pullback down into the 2.8s, 2.6s, for me, I think these areas are nice buys. And then looking at finally the S&P, which is a new introduction. I've been getting a few messages privately on if I could do the S&P and stock market. And I thought I would now include it in the analysis. And really based on the fact that the stock market does move in alignment with central bank policy, right? So as we can see, if we go to the stock market channel, what you'll see is that, stock futures, this was on the Wednesday, and it says here, stock futures climbed and bond yields tumbled as signs that inflation is cooling bolstered bets the Federal Reserve will cut rates this year. Now, what's that got to do with, why are stocks climbing and bond yields tumbling? Well, the stock market tends to appreciate when you have, when interest rates go lower, right? This is due to cheap money. You can borrow money for cheaper as interest rates get cut and then put it into more riskier assets and try to, get more of a yield. And that basically the money goes out of, currencies and into higher yielding assets. So although typically, people tend to think that if rates are being cut and there's a potential recession on the horizon, that this, the stock market should fall. And in fact, it's the opposite. Mostly you'll have money fly into, I say fly, but go into the stock market because you can buy, you can get dividends, obviously, and the like, and try and get more of a return on the stock market. So pullbacks into demand zones, really, if you think that the Federal Reserve will eventually still cut this year and cut next year, you should be looking at really any pullbacks as buying opportunities. And so I do think any pullbacks into these zones are nice. I do think the this area here as well should be a really nice buy as well. It's got nice confluence, and there's a bit of confluence here as well. So any pullbacks into these zones, I think, are really nice buying opportunities if you're just anticipating the Federal Reserve to eventually look to cut rates. The longer the Federal Reserve hold rates, though, We could see more of a sell-off because money remains expensive, and then you could see actually, you know, prices actually drop straight through those areas. But again, if you think that the Federal Reserve are looking to cut rates at least by September, October, then any pullbacks should be actually buying opportunities. So yeah, that's really the analysis for this week. Again, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share the video. Hope you have a great trading week, and all the best.